What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Imagine you're creating a text editor app, and at some point you decided to let users undo or control Z any operations carried out on the text. This feature has become so common over the years that nowadays people expect every app to have it. So, for the implementation, you chose to take snapshots of your text and save them as a history in some kind of storage. In this example, we took a snapshot of our text area every time we added a new word to the text we are writing. Later, when a user decides to undo what he or she wrote, the app fetches the latest snapshot from the history and uses it to restore what was previously written. Let's think about the snapshots we are taking. How exactly would you produce one? Suppose the object you are taking a snapshot of contains several fields and not just a simple text like this example. We'll probably need to go over all the fields of this object and copy their values into memory. However, for this to work, one of the requirements could be that all the fields in question should be declared as public. And unfortunately, most objects hide their significant data inside private fields. Ignore that problem for now and think about the actual snapshots we took. These snapshots will end up being several objects of one same class, and this class would have almost no methods, but lots of fields that mirror our initial object's state. Now, to allow other objects to write to and read data from a snapshot, you'd probably need to expose these fields by making them public, or using setters, or anything else. And by doing that, you'd be exposing all of the initial class fields, private or not. Moreover, other classes would become dependent on every little change made to the snapshot class. The problems we just experienced are caused by broken encapsulation. Some objects try to do more than they are supposed to. To collect the data required to perform some action, they invade the private space of other objects instead of letting these objects perform the actual action. So, how do we solve this? Well, the memento pattern is a behavioral design pattern that delegates creating the state snapshots to the actual owner of that state. Hence, instead of other objects trying to copy the initial object's state from outside of the class, the original class itself can make the snapshot since it has full access to its own state. Let's bring back the text editor example we saw at the very beginning, along with the text area class we had. This class will hold the original state of our object. In our case, we are going to keep it simple and let the state simply be the string or text stored inside the field where the user is typing stuff. Now, to delegate the creation of mementos or snapshots to this class, we have to create an inner memento class inside this one. The memento will have the same attributes as the text area, along with a getter that should be only accessible by the outer class or text area class only, hence the private keyword. To create snapshots or mementos, we need to add a method that returns a memento object storing the current state of our text. These mementos should be stored as a history inside a list or a stack, where we are going to keep track of all the snapshots we took. The class containing this history could be the editor class in this example. Now, when we need to roll back or undo the state of our original object, which is the text field, what we do is pop the latest memento in the stack, retrieve its saved state using the getter implemented in the text area class that calls the private getter of the memento class, and override the current state of the original object with the one we just popped. And that's it. We just implemented the undo functionality using the memento pattern. So, with the help of these classes, the person using this editor can write text and undo what he or she wrote, as you can see in front of you. Let's go ahead now and take a look at the structure or class diagram of the memento design pattern, all while relating it to the text editor example we just implemented. The implementation of the memento pattern relies on nested or inner classes, which you can clearly distinguish in the diagram here between the originator and memento classes. The originator class was the text area class of our previous example. This class can produce the snapshots of its own state, as well as restore its state from snapshots when needed. On the other hand, the memento class is a value object that acts as a snapshot of the originator's state. It's a common practice to make the memento immutable and pass to it the data only once via the constructor. The last thing you might notice here is the caretaker class, which was the editor in our previous example. This class knows when and why to capture the originator's state, and is also responsible for restoring the last or any particular originator state if need be. The caretaker keeps track of the originator's history by storing a stack or list of mementos. When the originator has to travel back in history, the caretaker fetches the required memento and passes it to the originator's restoration method. So, to recap, the memento pattern lets you save and restore the previous state of an object without revealing the details of its implementation. To do that, this pattern makes full copies of an object's state, including private fields, and stores them in a separate object. Additionally, by using the memento pattern, you delegate the creation of the object's state snapshot to the object itself, consequently making the original's object data safe and secure, as no other object can read or access the snapshot's data. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.